Au son des banjos, je l'ai reconnu, ce curieux sourire qui m'avait tant plu, sa voix si fatale, son beau visage pâle, mais mûre plus que jamais. Je me suis saoulée en l'écoutant, la voix fait oublier le temps, je me suis réveillée en sentant des baisers sur mon front brûlant, des baisers sur mon front brûlant. On s'est connu, on s'est reconnu, on s'est perdu de vue, on s'est perdu de vue, on s'est retrouvé, on s'est séparé, puis on s'est réchauffé. Chacun pour soi est reparti dans ton million de la vie. Je l'ai vu un soir, nala, elle est retombée dans mes bras, elle est retombée dans mes bras. Quand on s'est connu, quand on s'est reconnu, pourquoi se perdre de vue, se reperdre de vue, quand on s'est retrouvé, quand on s'est réchauffé, pourquoi se séparer?
Hi, Kaari.
Good morning, Charlotte. How are you?
Bonjour. Flora is going to arrive in a minute. She's just cooking something up.
Wonderful, wonderful. How are you?
Good, 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 good. It's really stormy here today. So it's been hot and we came back along through the valley. It was all beautifully misty. And then if we suddenly get cut, it's because there are huge thundery storms around the place.
Oh, wow. Okay. Okay. Yeah. So our connection is a little, from my end, it's a little fuzzy, but maybe it'll work itself out. But I can hear you.
Yeah. Okay. I think that's the fuzziness of being in Southwest France and having really bad internet. So in a thunderstorm. Yeah.
Exactly. Well, we're doing it anyway. I love it.
So today we went to our first market. So it was in Villefranche de la Rouergue, you know, that beautiful market, and everybody was out in their masks and everybody was looking at each other as if, do we kiss? Do we say hello?
Right.
And Flora, of course, was there sort of looking glamorous and both of us had our masks on. And one woman said, some mask, as if like, what are they doing without their masks?
Right.
Good morning.
Hello, Flora. Bonjour.
Bonjour. Comment ça va?
Ça va. Merci. Merci. I hear you went to Villefranche.
Yes. Yes. I love Villefranche because I was at school there for 3 or 4 years. Mm-hmm. So it has a completely different meaning for me. But it was really exciting. It was really nice. But really strange, as Mummy was saying, about like what to do and what not to do. And it's that whole Villefranche is very bastide town, the whole one way circle. And when you're in the market town, it's really tall around you, so you feel like everybody's sort of peering down upon you, and it was a little bit nerve-wracking.
Right.
But it was still quite nice to see see people.
But it was rather like, I mean, it's a typical medieval town. Those that know it, you walk through a dark street with glorious medieval mansions, which now have shops beside them. But you can see these doors, 13th century, and all the windows from the 13th up to the 15th century. And it was a bit like that this morning because you were sort of an unknown pilgrim walking along here into the unknown, and the nuns were selling the cheese in front of the church.
Right.
The peasants were looking particularly peasanty.
It's funny, it's like people want to stay away, but they still need to gossip because it's the point of mine.
Right.
So it's like people were whispering really loudly, but like 2 meters away from each other about like what somebody else has been up to, about what they're going to do this week. So the whole street, although there weren't that many people in it, was really loud.
Right. Did you have to get permission to go out to this market? No.
No, they lifted paper permission, not paper.
So we're now allowed to go anywhere within 100 kilometers from your primary residence.
Oh, wow. Okay.
But it's still very weird.
So you can go to St. Antonin.
Yes.
Will that market open up now, do you think?
It's going to, but just local producers.
Okay.
But we actually had to go to the Troc Brocante today in Villefranche, which is why we went there. And they were so pleased to see us because they've been shut for ages.
Yeah, I bet.
And you have to wash your hands when you go in. Right. You should wear a mask in every shop. It's a bit boring.
Right.
But anyway, it took us away from our garden.
Yes.
We've been in the garden. Whether you've been seeing Flora's Laura's messages, but we have so much rain and it's warm. Okay. And these are some of our snail
bugs. Wow. Oh my gosh. Huge.
Escargot.
They're nothing. I mean,
they are enormous. And when our
they're
house.
The same size as a car.
Oh my God. They're huge.
And when our house was a farm, they imported these snails in from the Bourgogne area.
Okay.
And they grew all over the place.
Okay.
They grew. They were snails. They lay their eggs about now.
Mm-hmm.
So when we've been gardening, we see lots of snail eggs. Then they all hatch out into baby snails. And in July, the snail season is open, rather like the shooting season.
Sure.
You are then allowed to go and collect your snails, and then you put them through the process of starving them. You sort of like feed them on sort of straw and sand to clean them through, and then you make them into the dish that we all know, les escargots. They're so
that
sweet.
One's rather camera comfortable.
So you from now until July, you'll just let them be in the garden.
Well, no, that's the problem. We don't like them in the garden because
sure.
when we're asleep, they eat everything.
Sure.
So we've been collecting them.
Okay.
And taking them out to French friends who love to have snails.
Right.
They love the idea of having food for free growing
sure.
in their walls.
Sure.
And we've been swapping it.
Okay.
So today was for a big bag of veal from a farm.
Nice.
And two days ago was for lots of different vegetables and some straw that we needed for our potager.
And what is a good barter? Like, how many snails do you get for a piece of veal? Like,
well, today, so... it's just strange, and it's so lovely because that's what the world should be, you know. We
right.
should be like a kilo of rabbit
mm.
or 2 kilos of flour, that kind of thing.
Right.
What's the currency? And lots of people have tried to establish, especially in small places like San Antonio, a non-monetary currency.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And we're seeing it now everywhere, and I love it. But like, I put my snails on Instagram.
Okay.
People have been messaging me saying, it's not the season, you can't pick snails, and all this is going on. Right. And then other people are messaging me saying, so, how much for the snails?
Right.
And then it goes on. Right. And she gave me
hello.
3 escargots.
Oh. Hello, boxes. Fidel. Hello, baby. Hi, honey.
Of veal in exchange of a box of snails. So it must be like, I don't know, 6 kilos of veal.
Ooh,
in exchange for...
That's pretty good.
Yeah, that's pretty
six
good.
Kilos of snails.
Yeah.
Oh, so it was about even. It was about even.
Probably
yeah.
about even.
Yeah.
On Monday, when it rained, we collected so many snails that we had a box that Flora and I couldn't carry together.
They're too heavy.
No.
Thank you.
No.
So, so we've got a lot of snails to give away.
So
that's
this
great.
Week, in the Northern Hemisphere, has been the what we call the Santa Glace, the Sainte Glace,
mm-hmm.
with our accent, Santa Glace.
Mm-hmm.
And it's when the three saints of the 11th, 12th, and 13th of May, they get together and they have dinner. And whilst they're having dinner, they don't pay attention to the weather. And so it goes pretty cold. And it's our last chance for frost of the season.
Okay.
So like we spoke to Malene last week and she was having snow this weekend.
Mm-hmm.
And you guys just turn down the AC or something.
Yeah.
But for us, it means loads of rain and often frost.
Sure.
It's quite exciting. So there's last dates for picking, not picking the cherries because the cherries are all coming to bloom. There's the snails all come out, different kinds of greens. So like the borage is all flowered this week, you know, borage flowers.
Oh yeah.
So that's
right.
Really exciting. And that comes with the green. So we went from really sunny to then suddenly torrential rain, and it meant that we could actually like repatriate, come back together and like plan more and do more and more cooking and more snailing. This one's really trying to make a run for it.
Yeah,
but it's,
oh yeah, right.
It's always that you never plant out your fragile plants until after this time, the Santa Glace,
the mid-May, the
when we've done
right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, when we've done our demonstrations before, we always have to remember that people they couldn't read, they couldn't write.
Mm.
They actually did their certain things through the year, or their recipes, like they made certain wines on Midsummer's Day. They made other things, started their preserves at certain moons.
Sure.
And those they did know. So this is a big gardening calendar, the Santa Glace.
Okay.
And for those who don't know the French calendar, every day of the year is a different saint's day.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So I had my saint's day. No, my saint's day is coming up.
Coming up.
It was Saint Judith last week, my mum's saint's day. Mm-hmm. And so there's a saint's day for every day. You have your birthday and you have your saint's day.
These are for common, quite common Christian names.
Right.
So, and it's something you would celebrate. In most families, you'd say happy saint's day, or you'd have a little gift, or you'd have a special meal. It's quite an important thing. It's sort of, and a lot of people are named after their saint day. Mm-hmm. So if they're born saying Julie, they will be called Julie. Although I don't know if that's the same. Probably it's the same.
Yes, there's
lots of saints too, so that's quite handy.
It's not necessarily related to your confirmation name. You know how, like, when you're confirmed at some point, then you have to choose a saint, and maybe, I don't know. That's the only thing I can think of that I could relate it to, because I don't think we don't sell. I know in France sometimes at the flea markets I'll see calendars,
yes,
listing out all the saints' days, and I don't think we have that here.
No, we've been actually talking about it, about what a project it could be of, like, associating different recipes to different saints' days, because it's a big part of our calendar. And we depend on the earth that we walk on. We depend on the earth that we're growing, we're planting in our life. And even more so this year, with not having, not going to a different place to work. We're going to be working from here.
Right.
We're going to depend on watching our season change so much, and also with the climate change issues, where we're used to have frost, we don't anymore. So we need to keep an eye on things that would have happened before and make sure they're being maintained.
Because
even if there's no frost, the asparagus is still going to be cut one day of the year. You know, there are still things that need to go on.
Yeah. So as you know, because you're always here in the asparagus season, on the Saint Jean, which is the 22nd of June, that's when they start. 21st, when they stop cutting asparagus. So even if you've got masses of asparagus, you don't pick it up to the Saint-Jean.
Okay.
And that was to tell the people of the land who, couldn't read, couldn't write, that from that day, all the goodness had to go into the plant and you mustn't pick it anymore.
Got it.
So because of the sand, the glass, and all of the rain that we've had, it's glorious, the amount of rain we've had. It's so beautiful out there. It's like, you can just squint and, like, see the fairies and the deers, and it's just all magical and rainy day.
And will you have rain for the next couple of weeks at least, right?
No, the sun's on its way. Yeah.
No kidding. Oh, that's great.
Yes, after the sun glass, then, I mean, we were swimming last week.
Yeah.
So it was hot enough to swim.
And we'll be swimming next week.
And we'll be swimming next week.
Wow.
So we've been getting indoor jobs done, and we've been being able to weed because the earth is nice and moist,
and plant and pick stuff that we wouldn't be able to normally do. So a lot of picking we've been doing is the nettles. Nettles are really good at the moment. So we've been picking up all of the nettles.
Oh, sure.
And as I was saying, with the borage flowers, and then there's the comfrey, and then a load of other plants. I have no idea what you call them in English, but they're all very tasty and very green, and they're like our spring greens.
Will you use them for cooking or for making like a tea or an infusion, or what will you do with them?
So you can use a lot. I mean, borage specifically, you can use for everything. The flowers are really pretty, and something we like to do is remove the flower once it's come out,
right,
once the bees have had a go at it, and put it in an ice cube tray with maybe some rose petals, maybe something else. Put the water in it and freeze it. So then in the summertime, we've got ice cubes with little pretty flowers in it.
And nice, yeah.
But the main reason is we use, we cut away the big leaves, and we make a really lovely compost tea for our plants with it.
Right.
And with the actual leaf of the borage, we make these very old-fashioned
aveyronnais.
I guess they're kind of like meat patties.
These are called farsou, and they are the peasant food that you would take in your lunch pack if you were going to plow or sow the fields at the moment.
Have I ever had this? I don't think I've had this.
I don't know. They're really,
they're peasant, they're poor people's food.
Yeah.
And they're a mixture of leftovers. So every nation has it. But because in the Aveyron there's lots of veal, it's generally with bits of leftover veal or pork.
Okay.
And then all the greens that you haven't eaten or that aren't going to actually make a dish, the leftover bread from the night before, which is soaked in perhaps your garlic and your dressing from the night before,
okay,
an egg, mix it all together and make a pate. And so it's very, very green. It's very tasty. And it's a leftover, use everything that you've got food.
Everyone's grandma has a different recipe of it, but it is the same basis of it. But it is a really homely thing. And it's something for going on to school in Villefranche, in the Aveyron. It was like, it was a Thursday thing. We'd go to the market and we'd have our coffee and we'd have farceau. And farceau is, in French, you add et if it's female and ou if it's masculine. Actually, you can use ou if it's female too sometimes. Of course, there are specific rules. For something that's smaller. So farce is the word for stuffing. And this just means a small little stuffing. And it is really just like a meat patty. And they're so lovely. But in these ones, we've got borage flowers. We've got nettles. We've got celery greens. We've got parsley stems, chives.
And then what are you serving it on? Do you serve it on like a cracker or on something? Or
you have it, you can have it just as an aperitif, just as a thing on the side. And then, or a lot of people, they add lardon and stuff, but, and they make it a more constitutional dish. Like you'd have a burger, but without the bun.
Okay.
So you'd have green salad with it.
Or I maybe see.
Some potatoes. They do these lovely potatoes in the Aveyron where they power boil the new potatoes. And they make a garlic and parsley butter with the fresh garlic green. And they pour it all over these new potatoes and then they squish them once. And then you have that with your meat and your salad and they're really tasty.
Oh, yeah.
You could have it with your aligot, which is also from that area.
Yeah. Sure.
The big aligot that we see on the market.
Sure.
They're stirring the potato around. So it's just something which when we go to Villefranche market, we would always buy one of those hot in the morning and gobble them up.
Yeah.
But you would, you know, you'd send your child off to school with one of those wrapped up in a little bit of greaseproof paper or somebody out to the fields.
And they're delicious.
Yeah.
I love
it. It's the poor peasant.
It's also a really good thing to make without, you can make them without meat too.
Sure.
You just use green. You can use the top leaves of spinach is always a good one because it's great. And also you can freeze it really well, but chard, the green of chards.
Sure.
You can do so much with that.
Right.
You can cast it, you can, but it makes a really good crunchy constitutional. It's actually quite nice with pak choy's too. Pak choy, bok choy's.
I love it. I love it. So, Judy, I'm just going to answer your question. I'm not sure why the sound isn't working. I hear Charlotte and Flora well. I'm not sure how everybody else is hearing you, but it's coming through to me. So Judy, I'm not sure. Maybe try your volume check, make sure your volume is on your phone. Okay, girls. So I loved hearing about that.
So the
aligot, just so you know, aligot, the first time I ever tried aligot, I think it was in St. Antonin. And I remember walking through the old farmer's market, probably with John Zabala and Sophia, you know, she was probably two or three. And I just remember, it's the same guy too, you know, he's been there for years, you know, stirring this massive, massive pot of...
With the big wooden spoon.
Of cheese and butter, I'm assuming, and potatoes.
No butter.
So for those of you who haven't met aligot, it's a way of mashing potato in an elasticated, clever manner. And they use just fresh potatoes and fresh, so powerful potatoes and... fresh tum, which
tum?
Is cow's milk
from
top of the mountain. Mm. And it's so fresh that it basically melts and turns to creamy. And they use these big wooden paddles and they lift it and they wiggle it and it pours down like a little volcano.
Right.
It's worth YouTubing because it's really satisfying to watch.
It's just a little piece of heaven on earth, you know, when you're in the middle of the market.
But a little bit goes a long way, as
totally.
We found when lots of people have bought them, you know, and we have those big, lovely coffees out on the market and everybody's so, I'll buy some. And then when afterwards,
I know.
Lots left.
I know. You just need a taster too, just to get the flavor. Get the flavor. Yeah.
But that again is something which comes from the Aveyron and the Massif Central. And it's that food that you'd make for lots of people cheaply.
Mm.
And when people get together, when they have their village fets, which they do all the way normally through the summer. So we'll see what happens this year. And they'd have the local sausages, the farceau, and the aligot.
Such a really clever way of making potatoes and cheese go a really long way.
Because
it's so rich that you only have a teaspoon.
And how do you spell aligot? Is it A...
A-L-I-G-O. aligot.
Right, exactly how it sounds.
Tom always says aligot round and round.
Right.
Because it's one of those things that's
exactly.
But I always think, you know, when we go around the market, it is rather like, you know, going around living installations like theatres. Everybody's performing.
It's so
and
true.
The aligot man's there. You've got
so
the big
true.
Pan of paella. You've got all everything changing, all the colours changing each week on the different stalls. And the aligot, the smells, because with he has a pan of the aligot, and then he has another pan, and that's the truffade, and that has garlic in it as well.
That's
garlic
right.
and parsley.
Right,
and
right.
that's my favorite, and the smells coming from that
it's
is
great.
Just delicious.
It's great. Yeah. Well, we're... So go ahead.
I'm going to say the other thing we've been eating a lot of
yes.
at the moment is cherries.
Okay.
Because... Again, we've got here a cherry clafoutis that's just come out of the oven.
Oh, my favorite. My favorite.
And clafoutis can be made with any fruits. And actually, you can make a savory clafoutis as well with a lentil flour. But we've got the cherry trees are very clever because each cherry tree gives its fruit. One gives 1 week and then the next one another week and then the next one another week.
Interesting.
So this,
right.
So we do you want to tell them about clafoutis?
Yeah, so I picked these last week, climbed up to the tippy top top of the tree, which is a lovely tree from the house actually. And clafoutis is one of those the really funny puddings that they're very specific about it. Apparently if you don't use the cherries whole, as you all know who have been to FG in the summer of FG in France. If you don't leave them whole, it doesn't count as a clafoutis. You have to have the pip in it.
That's right.
Which is always a big part of it. So a clafoutis is basically a flan with cherries, or with cherries is the original one inside of it. And it means clafout in Occitan, which is our traditional dialect, means to fill. And it is, again, a way of filling up
fill
the
up.
End of the meal. You know, it's just, it's a flan base
for
of
cheap.
Milk, for cheap, of milk, egg, and some people add cream, a bit decadent, but they add cream and milk and egg and a bit of sugar. But the trick, I think, the good bit is melting a bit of butter and putting it around as if you're doing for a cake and putting it around whatever dish you're putting it in. Shallow dishes work a bit better, but if you're really gourmand, you can make it in like a bowly dish.
Right.
And then putting sugar on the inside. And this is called chemising de moule. Which is a very common thing in cake making, but it means to put a shirt on the moule.
Okay.
And because the dish is so shallow, then you put your cherries in it, and then you pour your mixture on top.
I see. So cherries with the pit, they go in first, and then the pastry or the dough.
It's almost a pancake mixture, which you put over.
Right.
Yeah, pancake works fine.
But because you've got the sugar on the bottom... You can see it makes its own crust at the bottom.
Right.
So you can just spoon it straight out.
Yeah.
And clafoutis vary. You know, at this time of year, we have them. If we go to restaurants or if we go to friends' houses, you have them everywhere. Sometimes they can be a bit rubbery at the bottom.
Mm.
And that's different ways of making the clafoutis. We like ours to be still
crispier
at the top. And soft at the bottom, but still that you could actually turn it out like a cake.
I see.
It's got a hard bottom.
And I really like mine. The problem with cherries, the problem with leaving the pips in is that the fruit, when you eat it, is boiling hot because all the heat stays inside.
Exactly.
That's always a problem. My favorite ones are the apricot clafoutis.
Oh,
and they're
nice.
Just, they're so, they get the really rubbery bit, and also which our dishwasher uppers, Sophia and Peter, thank you for all the summers of doing that. But this becomes like caramelly on the outside,
right.
So it's kind of crunchy.
Right.
So if you get the apricot to go all smooth and soft, the pastry goes a little bit rubbery and the edge is crunchy.
Right.
For me.
I remember it well. Will you be sure to send us that simple recipe? So that, I mean, that's something people could do here almost year round with almost anything, you know.
Absolutely.
Right.
Yep. And the best part is that you can freeze them.
Oh,
that's my favorite.
Nice.
Is that like it's literally the cherry on top of the recipe. But yeah, you can put them in the freezer because they've got the fat content in them.
Sure.
And then you can bring them out and put them straight in the oven, and they take a bit longer, but it is worth, you know, whilst all the cherries and all the fruit is going, and if you're bored of making so many jams,
right,
it's worth just putting a load in the freezer if you, like us, invite people over for dinner and then completely forget that they're coming and have to magic dinner
for them.
Perfect. Especially magicking a dessert. Yeah, magic and dessert is the hard bit.
Exactly, yeah. Exactly. Well, I love checking in with you. I love seeing what you're doing, seeing Fidel. Well, and I can't wait till we can go out on a real field trip with you and see the markets or, you know, see your friends. I heard Jerome came over for lunch yesterday.
Mm-hmm. He did. He came over yesterday for his déjeuner.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Yeah. Asking about when his American ladies would come back.
I'm sure.
Of course.
Sure.
Of course.
Well, say hello to him for us. We'll see him. We'll see him soon, I'm sure.
And you're all good in LA?
We're good. Everybody's doing well here. And Sophia is doing well. And John Zabala, mom and dad, Molly, Ryan, my brothers, sisters, everybody's doing well. So we're lucky.
We loved your mother's sick craft.
Oh, it was so good.
I know.
Just that whole feeling of wanting to hug people even more because we can't at the moment.
I know,
but
right?
That was just like, oh.
She told me she didn't sleep. She was so nervous about it. And she said, you know, I had an upset stomach and this and that. And I said, I know. It's uncomfortable. And then afterwards she said, but I really liked it. I really had fun.
She was really good.
Okay, so really good. Craft class would kick every week.
Right. Yes. I'll get her working on the next one.
Just if she wants to like read us a story online or something. Totally. That would be really nice. Because she's really lovely to just listen to.
I'll tell her. Next Tuesday we are talking to a girl in London actually. Young girl named Jessie Chorley. And she was meant to come to Los Angeles this past April and teach. And we had to postpone that. So now she's going to hopefully come see us next November. So we're going to check in with her. But Flora, you'd love her because she's a big stitcher.
Good.
Big stitcher. Yeah. Jessie Chorley. So we'll do that next Tuesday at 9 a.m. Los Angeles time. So probably like 5 o'clock or 6 o'clock your time.
Yes, great. It's a very cheap time for us, so it's very handy.
Perfect.
Yeah. When we're just preparing. And did you play the record?
Of course. We played it loud. We played it loud.
We'll sing it really loudly.
Yes, we
Not
did.
Now, but
we did. I loved it. La Vie en Rose. It was wonderful.
Okay, so this week when we put this recipe on, we'll also put the words for "Non, je ne regrette rien."
Oh, okay. Okay, I like that one.
And if anybody hasn't seen the film La Vie en Rose, which is also known as La Môme, with what she called that...
Marion Cotillard.
Okay.
Who plays Edith Piaf so beautifully. It is the most fantastic film.
Okay, we'll put that up too.
The music running through that, and that explains at the end of her life why that song was so special, Non, je ne regrette rien. Mm-hmm.
Okay. We'll post the movie too. So once you send me that, I'll put it all up today.
Great. Cool. Good.
Awesome. All right, girls. Wonderful to see you. Wonderful to see you. Sorry?
Are you going to pass Sophia?
I was, but that was a no.
Yes.
Kaari, it's Tom. I just want to
Love
to John. Send love to John. I miss John.
Oh, I will.
We all miss John, too.
I expect to see him around about now.
I know.
Yeah, we want sea craft from...